Hello and good afternoon, Peter. Welcome back to the studio.
Hello, Jacqui. Hello, Steve.
Hello.
Peter, thank you for the copy of your new book, Christmas Every Day, Glam Rock. Yeah. It doesn't disappoint. It's equally as informative as the previous book you've written that we've spoken about on the programme. Now, I've got to ask you, is glam rock period your era, 1970 to 1976?
Well, I was born 1963, so it's the first music I really remember.
Oh, right, so I suppose it is.
Yeah, but if I'm completely honest, my favourite music would be more 60s stuff, especially 63 to about 67. That's the period I really specialise in. But yeah, I do love glam rock as well, yeah.
Now people never fail to surprise me, really. I've got a couple of guys down the studio, about in their 30s, 35, and their favourite music is 60s. And, people, as I say, never fail to surprise me. So, no. Pete, who designed the cover of your book? It was fun looking at the faces and trying to pick out who the artists were.
That was my other half, Heather. She's very good at drawing. We just looked at loads of photos and put them all together. And then, I'm sort of a... She did loads of individual drawings, and I sort of put them together, so it was between us. But she did the drawing, she did the hard stuff. So.
Yeah, a combined effort. Only indoors, when my son looked, we were having differences of opinion. I was saying one was one person, and he was saying, no, you got that wrong.
I should have put a little key inside, really, so there they are.
So it is quite a talking point, even just looking at the cover. So I was pleased to note that Alvin Stardust was mentioned in the book and his debut album, The Untouchables. And as you rightly say, he's a glam update of Gene Vincent with a little bit of Dave Berry mixed in. Because if you remember, Dave Berry never wanted to be seen, did he, when he appeared on Top of the Pops? He had these black gloves on, and he used to hide his hand and hide behind his collar and, so on and so on. My two favourite songs from that album, My Cuckoo and Jealous Mind.
Yeah, fabulous.
Are on that book. Only... Alvin Stardust, originally Shane Fenton and the Fentones, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He only got that by default because the other group, his real name, Bernard Dury, the other guy from the Fentones, Johnny Thixton, he died, and then Alvin Stardust, or Shane Fenton as he was known then, was picked to take his place, wasn't he? And then he sort of evolved.
And even Alvin Stardust, he wasn't the original Alvin Stardust.
Wasn't
Peter Shelley. No, Peter Shelley actually did the studio recording of My Cuckoo. And he went out. He did one TV appearance, and it wasn't in leather. It was like a bizarre Clans outfit for, I think it was Lift Off with Asia, that program.
Mm-hmm.
But only did the one appearance, and then he didn't want to do it. So they got Shane Fenton in to become Alvin Stardust.
Oh, I didn't know that. So you've told me a little bit more that I didn't know. So, Pete, do you think 1970s artists were more creative than they are today?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And most of them, they'd been around a few years before, well, certainly Alvin Stardust, but, like Slade and David Bowie and Mark Bolan, they'd had records, flop records, a lot of them, throughout the 60s, but they'd also played the clubs and everything else. So they'd learnt their trade, they'd really learnt how to play, and also they'd picked up, the best bits from the 60s, take a bit of the Rolling Stones, take a bit of the Kinks, blah, blah, blah. So they had a lot to work on as well, and the experience. But very creative indeed.
So, Pete, what made a few chaps suddenly decide to not only sing, but to wear star-spangled clothing and paint their faces with makeup? I can't get my head around that one.
it did start, really, in the late 60s. I mean, the Rolling Stones... For their video for Jumpin' Jack Flash, they all wore face paint. And remember Arthur Brown, The Crazy World of Arthur Brown?
Oh, yes, love that one,
Well, similar, but then But then a bit later, it started to become a bit too serious with all the prog rock and the Emerson, Lake and Palmer, which I like. It's all got its place. But, it wasn't really appealing to the teeny boppers and the teenagers. And then Mark Bolan, someone he knew, a friend of his, I can't remember her name, but put a bit, just before he went on Top of the Pops, put a bit of glitter on his face, and everyone went wild. And then the Streets started doing it, and then Dave Hill of Slade started doing it, and then Bowie started doing it, and everyone. It started really with Mark Bolan, yeah.
Yeah, because David Bowie went over the top, didn't he, with the eye stuff and the makeup.
Yeah. Yeah. I think he saw it.
And then I turned to page 59, and I found the female icon of glam rock, Susie Quattro, with her album of the same name. And the album, a great mix of original songs and covers. Her own song, 48 Crash, mixed in with covers of the Beatles, the Rolling Stones and Elvis. Now, who would dare to cover an Elvis song?
She loved Elvis, probably still does, she has not. But Susie Quattro was interesting because she was the opposite of everyone else. I mean, it was nearly all males, nearly all British, and she didn't have glittery clothes, and she rarely even wore any makeup.
No, so that's
you had
right.
An American female in black leather without makeup, but still a glam rock icon, it's incredible, really.
Yeah, but she had she stood up on stage, like, everyone will listen. I mean, the songs,
a fantastic musician as well. She actually played bass on a couple of Cozy Powell hits. She's one of the top bass players, ever, really. She's not just a great singer and a great showwoman. So, she's got it all, Susie. I love Susie Quattro.
Only I was talking about Susie a few weeks ago to Darren Johnson, and I think...
He was saying that
Elvis rang her on hearing his song, All Shook Up, sung by her. And he invited her to visit him at Graceland's. But Darren tells me she didn't think she was ready just yet to face Elvis in case he asked her to sing with him. And by the time she was, in 1977, sadly, Elvis had passed away.
Yeah, I believe that's a true story,
That's what he was saying. Very interesting. So how far back in time would you say the tradition of drumming and of rock guitar goes? How far back? I mean...
That's a difficult one. There's been so many arguments. The first rock and roll record, really. Fats Domino, he had drums on some of his records, 1949, 1950.
Yeah.
He called it Rhythm and Blues, but it was as good as rock and roll. And then Bill Haley, by 1951, 1952, he started initially with country songs, but then he started doing these covers of people like Joe Turner, all these black rhythm and blues artists, but putting his bent on it and putting a strong backbeat. And it's difficult to say it was the originator, but it goes back, I mean, everyone seems to think it started when Elvis, in 1956, but really it's been around, 5 or 6 years before that in some form or another.
Because, as I don't know whether you would agree, rock music doesn't follow any particular pattern, does it?
No.
Yeah, anyway, going on. From the 1970s, we speak of such genres as glam rock, progressive rock, folk rock, punk, reggae, metal and synth pop. Now, out of all that lot, I can probably recognise glam rock, reggae and synth pop. So, Peter, looking at this era from a musical historian's point of view, what was the difference between the glam rock 1970 to 1976 and punk rock of the 1977 to 1979? What was the difference?
Yeah. To me, there wasn't really. That's a trouble with genres. They're often blurred. On T-Rex's final tour in 1977, he was supported by the Damned, with Captain Sensible and Dave Vanian, a very out there punk group. But they loved each other. They admired each other. Mark Bolan was telling interviewers, "Oh, this exciting new group," and. And and the Damned are hanging about on the tour bus with him, yeah. And they idolise Mark Bolan and people like that. So yeah, it's very, very much blurred. I mean, you know, different music, different outfits, but you know, it comes from the same thing as well. And a little bit later, Adam and the Ants.
I loved Adam and the Ants. Yes.
Oh yeah, but he was taking a lot. A bit of Bowie, a bit of the Glitter Band with the two drummers even. So he was very influenced by glam rock and a lot of these synth bands like the Human League. They cite people like Roxy Music, who you just played, and Bowie. So it all goes in. They all influence each other really. So yeah.
And you've got them all in the book. Now I was pleased to see that another of my favourites was in the book, David Essex. I think we all loved him, even when he was older. Lost his mop of dark hair and appeared in EastEnders as Eddie Moon. Do you remember?
Yeah.
But anyway, let's get back to the albums. I'm getting a bit carried away here.
I'll just say something about David Essex. I used to be a doorman at Margate Winter Gardens, which had closed recently, but up until about a dozen years ago, for a few years there. And I was never particularly a fan of David Essex, but people were saying, we've got David Essex coming. I said, oh, well, he said, you've got to see him. I absolutely love the show. He's just so charismatic. He's a fantastic performer. And ever since I saw that show, I'm a fan. I really am.
Now, David didn't exactly dress as glam rock star, did he?
No.
His genre of music only touches on glam rock, but well worth including in your book. And I do believe he had 16 top 40 albums. And I think I'm fairing saying, as you said yourself, Rock On and Lamplight are half decent glam rock songs.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. To be honest, I mean, this book is 200 albums. And I mean, a few people, you wouldn't really call them glam rock, but they touched on it. For instance, the Rolling Stones, Rod Stewart and the Faces, Elton John, he was very flamboyant, Queen, Sensational Alex Harvey Band. Were they really glam rock? Were Shawaddy Wally glam rock? Were Bay City Rollers glam rock? But they touched on it, so I've included them. So.
I'm impressed with the book, I don't mind telling you.
Thank you.
Now, David Essex was a very talented actor. He played the part of Jesus in Godspell. And then he was the working class boy who wanted to be a rock star in That'll Be the Day.
And I love that.
And Stardust, which was the film that had the jukebox in it, because a Balami jukebox, because that's to me was made the film. I don't know which one it was.
It must have been That'll Be the Day, because that was sort of his early years and him coming up to be a star. I think Ringo Starr was fantastic. They made such a good pair in that film. Yeah. I absolutely love that film. It's a few years since I've seen it. I must dig it out tonight now. So.
And then I turn to nearly towards the back of the book. Let's have a look. Page 192. And the album cover of David on the Street Essex. Now that, I don't know whether it's a... Is it a pen and ink drawing? It's not a photograph, is it, of David Essex?
No,
it's really fantastic.
It is. It's some sort of drawing, yeah.
Yeah,
It is a great shot, isn't it? Yeah.
I like that. Yeah, if it was bigger, I might have put that on my wall. As old as I am.
I'm sure quite a few ladies did, young ladies, put them on the wall.
And old ladies. Pete, how long did it take you to accumulate all this information for this book? And how did you decide who to include? Are there some personal favourites amongst the albums?
First of all, it took me on and off probably about 2 years, but it was between projects. I'm always promising my other half, when you finish a book, she says, right, relax for a month or two, relax,
And you go, no.
And then after a fortnight, I'm starting making notes, So it was between doing the two Top of the Pops books and other little projects for about 2 years. But who to include? I mean, that's a difficult one. I mean, I love Mudd. I thought Mudd was a great band, they have to be. And Shawaddy Wally, early Shawaddy Wally stuff. So, were they really glam rock? I don't care. I like them. I want them there. So.
It's a fantastic book, as I say. Another fantastic book out of the others that you've spoken to me about on the programme. Now, David Bowie is is mentioned with the album The Man Who Sold the World.
Yeah.
Now, the album cover has David Bowie reclining on a sofa, looking a bit like a mermaid. The main song, or should I say the album title, I think was grossly overlooked by the public until a cover version by Lulu was released. What's your thoughts on that one, Pete?
Yeah, and...
the other group, I can't think who they are. There was another group that did...
Oh, Nirvana did it later.
That's right, right.
But, yeah, Lulu, a fantastic record, and... I believe David Bowie plays saxophone on it. I wouldn't swear to that. Don't quote me. But anyway, well, two great glam rock records, singles, which I think, but unfortunately they're not in there because they didn't do glam rock albums, The Man Who Sold the World by Lulu and Back Off Boogaloo by Ringo Starr. I mean, that is a fantastic glam rock record, but he never did a glam rock album, so, he's not in it. It was just a one-off. Really,
I do remember Ringo's song. Yeah, that was good. Yes, you're right. Now, after the legendary Woodstock Festival in the USA in 1969, would you say that there was an increase in music festivals in the 1970s, basically created by these groups?
Yes, there was.
Because we had Glastonbury, didn't we?
Yeah, Woodstock was really the peak of the love and peace thing, because a few months later they had Altamont in California with the Rolling Stones and Jefferson Airplane, where someone actually got killed. And after that, the old atmosphere, I'm not saying all festivals are violent after that, but it transferred gradually, from the hippie area to the heavy metal area and the prog rock era. And, it wasn't all flowers in the hair anymore, really.
No. It wasn't all peace and love.
No.
Right, so I was talking to Steve about the cover of your book. Go on then,
oh,
Steve.
Oh, yes, yeah. Peter. A lovely, lovely front cover of the book there. And is it drawn by a pencil? And how long did it take to do the front cover of the book? Because you mentioned...
My other half. She actually did individual drawings of the band members, and then I sort of resized them, put it together, pasted it together. But I wanted something sort of like a glam rock version of Sgt. Pepper, but as a drawing. So it's sort of that, really, in a way.
Oh, brilliant. It's a great book. It really is great.
Thank you.
And it's definitely an educational book as well. So somebody wants to know a lot about how glam rock came about and the history of glam rock and everything else and the artists and the covers, they can pick up that book and learn a lot from that book. So, I mean, it's a great book. I'd like to read it fully myself on a cold winter's night as the winters are drawing in. So, yeah. Yeah, very, very good book, Peter. Really is great. Keep up.
Perfect Christmas present.
Yeah, exactly. Great idea for all those who are thinking about what can I get my partner. Good idea. Good plug there.
Couldn't resist it.
Yeah.
Okay, and then I noticed, Peter, you had Slade got a mention with their album Slade in Flame.
Yeah.
Would you say the album songs being set in 1966 and having a real 60s feel to them? So far, so far, so good. Wishing You Were Here, Far, Far Away. And it was said, I don't know how true this is, it was said that John Lennon commented... back in 1973, saying on Noddy Holder's voice, "Who is this bloke? I love his voice. He sounds a lot like me."
I don't doubt it. I don't doubt it at all. Yeah, especially when sort of less, shouty songs. How does it feel? And every day, it sounds very Lennonish.
Yeah, and it said also that John Lennon played harmonica on Slade's big Christmas song, "Merry Christmas, Everybody."
I don't think that's true. I don't know.
It's only
I know he collaborated with David Bowie on "Fame." He played guitar on "Fame," and he also what's the one? Oh, and with Elton John on John Lennon's own hit, Whatever Gets You Through the Night.
Mm.
Elton John sings on that and plays on that. So he did collaborate, yeah. He had his finger on the pulse, yeah, he really did. So,
yeah, he obviously liked the group. So, Peter, yeah. Who do you think were the best groups and which artists at that time influenced other artists, would you say?
They were also influential, but Slade, yeah, as you mentioned, yeah, fantastic live band as well, and yeah, great musicians and what a voice. But yeah, I suppose, I mean, Oasis, you know, 20-odd years later, they covered "Come on, Feel the Noise," you know, I believe as a B-side. I'm not a huge Oasis fan, but they talked about, you know, the influence of Slade. So Slade, Roxy Music, Bowie, of course, was very influential. T-Rex. And I'm sure, you know, Susie Quattro, you know, she must certainly the Runaways with Joan Jett, you know, she influenced her. But I'm sure, you know, even people like Susie from Susie and the Banshees, she must have looked, you know, as a role model and think, you know, I can be a front woman, you know. So I'm sure Susie Quattro, yeah, as well, yeah. So.
Yeah. I mean, glam rock from the 70s, everybody thinks, oh, glam rock's from the 70s and everything, but it bled into the 80s, didn't it? It did carry right through to the 80s, didn't it, Peter?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I don't think anything really stopped. You know, rock and roll never really stopped, punk never really stopped, disco never really stopped. It just becomes something else, but the influence is still there, yeah. So.
Yeah, interesting. Very much interesting there, Peter. Yeah.
Now, Peter, you also mentioned in the book, you mentioned ELO, Elton John, T-Rex, 10cc and loads more that I recognise. There's one band in there that I don't recognise. It doesn't even spring to mind, as old as I am. The sensational Alex Harvey Band. They don't ring a bell. Can you enlighten me on them?
They had a big hit with... He was a Scottish guy, Alex Harvey, a real character. He'd been around for years then. I said earlier, he'd been around for years. But he won a competition in the late 50s as Scotland's answer to Tommy Steele. That's how long he'd been around.
Oh, right.
So, it was in his 40s when he made it big with the sensational Alex Harvey Band. But they had a big hit with a revival of Delilah, the Tom Jones hit.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah, that was their biggest hit. But... they were sensational, and their albums were a bit patchy, to be honest, but I've seen videos of them, and I've spoken to people, you know, they had a unique stage act, they lived up to the name, you know, certainly unique, even if you don't think they're sensational, they're unique Alex Harvey Band, yeah. So.
No, when I looked through the book and started reading it, well, T-Rex, you know, everything sprung to mind. And when I came to that group, the sensational Alex Harvey Band, I sort of sat looking at the page and looking at the page, willing my mind to jump into action, and it didn't. And I thought, I have to ask you.
There's one thing, Peter, getting back to a glam rock, do you reckon a glam rock as we see in the 70s, would you reckon that will be revived in the future anytime?
I don't think anything's exactly revived, but the influence is always there. There was an artist called Goldfrapp a few years ago, and that sounded, and she looked very glam.
Yeah.
And in the 80s, there was Doctor and the Medics, with Spirit in the Sky. So these things, sort of come up and then go again, every so often. So I wouldn't rule it out, put it that way. So.
Yeah. What goes round comes back round, doesn't it? Every 10 years, I reckon.
Exactly,
A bit like fashion, really.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah, but it really is. It's fashion in music, definitely, yeah.
I would say to the listeners that if you're interested in glam rock albums, Peter's book is the book you need to buy. It's well documented, and it's a mine of information of that period. As the book is called Christmas Every Day, Glam Rock Albums 1970 to 1976. And where can we get a copy, Pete?
Amazon. The biggest bookshop in the world, Amazon.
Okay. And I think it will make an excellent Christmas present, as Steve has already said.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And before I I let you go, what I wanted to ask you about was the new book coming out, Undercovers, 500 Rolling Stones cover versions that you must hear. And you tell me you've interviewed over 100 people.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about it without giving too much away.
Well, I interviewed my 115th person today, so there you go. Mostly by email, but it'd just be, the research, I found thousands. I must have found about 3,000 cover versions, believe it or not, and
wow.
I've listened to every one of them. But some of the people I've interviewed, like Sandy Shaw, Mark Almond, Wendy James of Transvision Vamped, Steve Harley, quite a few others, members of the Searchers, whatever, a lot of obscure artists, but I'm very, very excited about this book,
I bet you are. And so when do you think it'll be finished?
I'm a fast worker. I'll go on holiday next week, a week.
A well-earned rest.
Yeah, it's my other half's birthday, so she's forcing me to have a rest. But probably November or December. I'm hoping to get out just before Christmas, yeah.
Okay, we look forward to that. I really will look forward to that one. And I'm going to let you go now. I'm going to thank you for coming to the studio this afternoon, and we wish you every success with the book. And for your partner, Heather, happy birthday. We're going to play you in a moment. David Essex and Rock On.
Great, thank you very much.
Happy birthday. Thank you for joining us this afternoon, Peter.
It's been
a pleasure, as always.
Bye. David Essex there with his Rock On.
Aww.
And that went out to Heather with happy birthday from myself and all of us down here on Gateway 97.8.